Well, hey everybody, and welcome to the online version of the worship service. Here at St. Paul's, we are a people who believe that God's Word is at the center and Jesus Christ is our Lord. And we're excited that you're joining us today. Just really have one announcement, and that is to draw your attention to the National Day of Prayer. And we have a board right here with the sign-up sheet, and you could take a devoted 15-minute time slot to pray on May 6th. And so we have all the times listed here. You can come by the church building and fill out your name, or you can contact the church office and we'll write you down if the time's not taken. And so we want to encourage you on May 6th, on the day of National Day of Prayer, we want to encourage you to come and be a part. We have a prayer gathering and a breakfast on Thursday, May 6th at 6:30 a.m. And we're going to take some time to, you guessed it, pray. We'll have tables with prayer guides, and a table leader will help us pray through each of the topics on that prayer list. And then we're just going to devote some time to praying as a big group, praying as a small group, praying silently, praying individually. We just want it to be a day of prayer for our nation and for every nation, for our local place and for every place. We want God to do a work. We want God to push back the darkness and bring in the light of the gospel of Jesus. And so that's what we're shooting for National Day of Prayer. And then throughout the day, if you choose, you can come by the church building or wherever you're at, home, work, school, you can pray. You can pray. And then here at 6:30 in the evening, we are going to have a prayer and worship gathering. And so we're excited about that on Thursday, May 6th, and we want you to be a part. So come and join us. If you have any questions at all, you can let me know, or you can contact Shauna Ideas, and she would love to answer them. So that's really all the announcements I have. And so with that, let's pray together. And please join me. Father, thank you for this time of worship. Thank you that we get to sing to you, we get to hear your word, and we get to pray. God, help us know how important prayer is. Help us know how much we depend on you. Jesus, you said that apart from you, we can do nothing. We're like a dead branch lying far away from the tree. God, may that not be so. May we abide in you, be with you, and bear much fruit as you've promised. Lord God, we need you. We need you desperately. Come and help us worship. Come and help us go from this time of worship and serve you with our lives. Serve you in our devotion. Serve you in our love. Serve you in loving and serving people, our neighbors, the poor, our families, our father and mother, our kids, our grandkids. We need you. Fill us, Holy Spirit. And we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.
The scripture reading today is found in Hebrews chapter 7, verses 23 through 28. Hebrews chapter 7, starting with verse 23. The former priests, on the one hand, existed in greater numbers because they were prevented by death from continuing. But Jesus, on the other hand, because he continues forever, holds his priesthood permanently. Therefore, he is able also to save forever those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. For it was fitting for us to have such a high priest, holy, innocent, undefiled, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens, who does not need daily, like those high priests, to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins, and then for the sins of the people, because this he did once for all when he offered up himself. For the law appoints men as high priests who are weak, but the word of the oath, which came after the law, appoints a son made perfect forever. May God bless the reading of his word.
Great high Hey, I have a question. Can anyone tell me what this sign means? Any ideas? What does it say? Keep out. What does that mean? Has anyone ever seen a sign like this in someone's yard or something? Does it mean that they want you to come in and they want you to be there and hang out on their land? No, I don't think so. I think it means that they don't want you there. I think it means that they want you to stay away. Go away. Stay off my land, right? Keep out. Get out of here. Has anyone ever been told stay away before? Keep out. Get out of here. You don't belong in our group. You don't belong with us. You gotta leave. I think we've all been told that, or we've all seen these signs before. And you know what's really interesting? God could tell us to keep out. God could tell us to go away. Why is that? Because of our sin. Because of the bad things that we do, God can tell us to stay away, that he doesn't want us to be around, that we need to stay off his land. Because we've done bad things. We've done things that he's told us not to do, and we haven't done things that he's told us to do. So he could tell us, keep out. I don't want you around. But you know what's really good? God doesn't do that. God doesn't want us to stay away, but really he wants the opposite. God wants us to come and be with him. He doesn't say keep out. He says come in. Come and be with me. Come and spend time with me. Jesus tells a story about a judge, and there was a lady bothering the judge a lot. And the judge says, all right, I'll give you what you want. And Jesus said, if this judge from a lady bothering him gives her what she wants, how much more does God, your Father who loves you, how much more does he want you to come and bother him? Come and be with him. God wants that from you. There's a really good Bible verse, and it's from Hebrews chapter 7, and it's, it is verses 24 and 25. So if you have your Bible, you can take it out with me. Hebrews 24 and 25. And it basically says that Jesus lives forever. So he's in heaven with God forever. And he is able to save completely those who draw near to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them, to pray for them, to plead for them. So Jesus lives forever, and so we can draw near to God. What does it mean to draw near to someone?
Hey, Scott, what are you doing?
Oh, hey. Well, now that you're here, I'm drawing near to you. Yeah, I don't think that's what it means. I think it actually means that Jesus brings us to God's house. Have you ever been to a friend's house and, you know, you knock on the door and you say, hey, is such and so home? And they say, no, he's not home. And then you probably leave, right? But if your friend brings you to their house, their parents are like, come on in. You're welcome here. Jesus is God's son, and Jesus brings us to God's house. We're welcome with him. We get to come near, draw near to God through Jesus. He doesn't say keep out. He says, through Jesus, come in. It's not by how good we are. It's not by what we've done. It's because of Jesus. God says, come on in. Let's remember that. Let's come to God a lot. Let's pray to him a lot, because he wants us to be with him. He doesn't say keep out. He says, get in here. Thanks for joining me, and may God bless you.
Darkness.
Well, as we can continue our series looking at encouraging believers, I'd like to ask you, let's pray together. Father God, we thank you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for your promises to us. And God, we're going to hear some really good promises from Hebrews chapter 7 today. And I pray that as we hear them, we would take them to heart. We would know that Jesus lives forever, that we can draw near to God as early and as often as we want to through him, that he is our Lord. He will save us completely as we call on him. He lives forever to do that, and he'll never let us down. He'll never turn us back as we come to him, as we draw near to him. You promise that you'll draw near to us. And so we take those promises to heart. We ask that you would bless our time in the Word today. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, again, we are continuing our series, Encouraging Believers, looking at the letter to the Hebrews. And before we start looking at the passage, I want to tell you about the day I turned 24. Now, before I tell that story, is anyone feeling old today? Anyone feeling old, achy, cranky, anything like that? Any old feelers out there? All right. So when I turned 24, like the day of, you know, I was 23 before that. You know, I just felt good. I felt kind of indestructible. You know, I knew I wasn't, but I just felt like I could do anything. You know, I was doing all the same athletic and silly stuff I did in high school as far as physical activity. But the day I turned 24, something was different. You know, on your birthday, people ask you, well, do you feel any older? And every year before that, I was like, no. But when I turned 24, I just something clicked, something switched. When I got up, I was like, why is my back kind of stiff? This is strange. And so when I turned 24, I started to experience a little bit of physical weakness. I wasn't able to do all the things I did in high school. I wasn't able to jump as high or run as fast or do things without getting hurt. Pretty much any time I tried to do anything, I hurt myself. And so I'm just feeling that physical weakness. And for those of you who are too young, that are younger than that and haven't started feeling that physical weakness, you will. It's just the way life goes. Just by nature of living in a fallen, sinful world, we kind of break down. We feel that physical weakness. And as I think about that physical weakness, but that has started happening the day I turned 24 and it's been progressing ever since, I also think about other areas where I have human weakness. I think about emotional weakness that I have. You know, I think about after Natasha and I had Kylo and going through that experience of learning how to be a father to a newborn baby, I can tell you I was not emotionally strong. I was not emotionally strong. I was stressed out. I was anxious. I was just kind of living in fear. I was just not sure what was going on, and I wasn't really being very strong for my wife, who had just gone through, you know, birthing a child, and so that wasn't helpful. And that emotional weakness was really clear to me during that time. There's also character weakness that I've experienced. Can anyone relate to this? When you're tired, your character just goes boom, just down all the way. Like if you're tired or if you're achy, you know, you're just like, I'm not being nice to nobody today. And I've felt that before. And sometimes when I say things to people, like I'm just answering them the way I thought I should, and then I answer them, and it comes out really curt. It comes out really like snippy, and I'm like, oh, that didn't come out right, you know. And I'm tired, and my character's not good enough to go and remedy the situation. It's like, well, I guess that's over, you know. And like we feel weakness in character. Any memory weakness out there? Yeah, I've been going through memory weakness, I think, since forever. And I don't know what that means when I get older, but sometimes I'm talking with Natasha and she brings up an idea and I'm like, that's a terrible idea. And she says, well, that was your idea. You said that like 2 days ago. And I'm like, oh, why would anyone say something like that? I just forget things. I forget to do things. I think I'm very like narrow, one focus minded, and so I just forget everything else around me. So I've experienced that weakness, and sometimes that weakness gets me in trouble. I don't remember something important. People are counting on me and I let them down. I just feel that weakness. Sometimes I feel weakness in situations. I don't know what to do or to say. Someone shares something that's really troubled them or hurt them. I don't know what to do. Sometimes something happens and a decision needs to be made right now, and I don't feel like I can make that kind of decision right now. Feeling the weakness. Older I get, the more weak I become. And the Bible would say that God has numbered our days. And we must consider that as our days are numbered, the older we get, the weaker we become, and the closer we come to the ultimate weakness, the weakness that we have no control over, and the weakness of death. Kind of morbid, but it's really something that we need to have on our minds and be thinking about and wondering about. And so we experience this weakness. But from Hebrews chapter 7, we have a lot of hope. Why do we have a lot of hope? It sounds pretty hopeless. We're weak, we're tired, we're dying a little closer every day. What's the hope here? The hope that I want to share is that even though we are weak, even though we let ourselves down, we let other people down, Jesus will never let us down. If you're taking notes, write that down. Jesus will never let us down. Our hope is that Jesus lives forever, and we are guaranteed a way to draw near to God through him forever. We are guaranteed Jesus lives. That's the best part about the resurrection, I think. That's my favorite part about the resurrection, is that Jesus lives forever to save to the uttermost completely all that call upon him. Paul says that he is at the right hand of the Father and he lives forever to intercede for us. Christ has died, but more than that, was raised, and he's with the Father pleading and praying for us. That's our hope. Jesus will never let us down. He lives forever. He doesn't have that weakness. He doesn't have that lack of strength that we all experience. He'll never let us down. And so, in your Bibles, we're going to be looking. Don't turn there yet. We're going to be looking at Hebrews chapter 7. But I want us to start with a little bit of background. And that background comes from Genesis chapter 14. So I would encourage you, take your Bible out and go to Genesis chapter 14. As we've been looking in our series of encouraging believers, the writer of Hebrews is writing to Jewish Christians and encouraging them to hold fast to Jesus. There's a temptation through persecution or just a lack of something that these Jewish Christians are thinking about going back to Judaism, leaving Jesus behind, leaving their Messiah, their Savior behind, and going back to the way it used to be. Who likes change? Yeah, nobody really likes change. And so these Jewish Christians, they're like, change is hard. Change leads us to get our stuff stolen and us getting beat up. We kind of want to go back to the way things used to be. And so the writer is encouraging them not to do that. And The case that he's making in Hebrews chapter 7 is he's looking at the priesthood in the Old Testament. Now, if you remember, in the book of Exodus, God set up a priesthood through a guy named Aaron, which was Moses' brother. And through Aaron and his children and their children, you have all the priests that served at the tabernacle and then later the temple in Jerusalem. And so you have all these people who are making sacrifices for people, helping people draw near to God, who are praying for people, interceding for them. And there were many of them because there were a lot of people. And Aaron had a lot of kids. And so you have these Old Testament priests, and the author is looking at them and say, that was great, praise God, but God has given us a new and better hope. God has given us a new way. Now, Aaron and the high priest was from the tribe of Levi. You know, Jacob had 12 sons. One of those sons was Levi. Levi had a tribe, and Aaron was from that tribe. And so all the priests were Levites. And the author says earlier in chapter 7, Jesus was from Judah. How do we work this out? And the case that he's going to make is he's going to say the old covenant, the covenant that God made with Moses. That is the old covenant, and now we are in the new covenant, where there's a new priest and a new priesthood. And there's not the law. We don't walk under the law. We are under grace. And we have a better hope through Jesus. And the person that he points to make this case is a guy named Melchizedek. This morning I was doing the text to speak, you know, where you hit the little microphone and in the phone. And I said Melchizedek, and the words milk is a deck came up. So not too much familiarity with the word Melchizedek, but we're going to look at him. You can call him Mel if you like. We're going to look at Mel here in Genesis chapter 14, and we're going to look in verse 31. So join me there. Genesis 14, verse 31. We are going to look at verse 18. Genesis 14, verse 18. And it says, and Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought out bread and wine. He was priest of God Most High. And he blessed Abraham and said, blessed be Abram by God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth. And blessed be God Most High, who has delivered your enemies into your hand. And so we have this guy named Melchizedek, and he comes out and he does two jobs. What are his two jobs? King and priest. King of Salem, which became Jerusalem, and a priest of the one true God, God Most High. And so he comes out, and Abram at the time had just went and rescued his nephew Lot from the hands of a lot of evil kings. Okay, so Abram was just won a lot of victory, and he came to be blessed by this guy named Melchizedek. And Melchizedek was a priest, and he was a king. And the author kind of looks at this guy and he says, okay, how was Jesus like Melchizedek, this priest, not related to Abraham, not related to Aaron? How was Jesus like him? If you look, verse 18, it says he brought out bread and wine. Kind of familiar. We do that once a month at least. And so bread and wine is kind of like Jesus. He was a priest of God Most High. The author of Hebrews would say that Jesus is the one high priest, the greatest high priest of God Most High. How else? He blessed Abram. He blessed him. He gave him a blessing of God, and Jesus does that for us. Jesus helps us draw near to God and be blessed by him. He intercedes for us. He prays for us. He pleads for us, and he blesses us. So that's looking at the priest. Melchizedek was also a king, and we know Jesus is king. Amen. King of kings, Lord of lords. When you look at the word Christ, you can see God's promised king in that word. He's the Messiah. He is the Lord. And we see that there's a few kind of parallels here with this guy named Melchizedek back in the Old Testament. And so we're going to look, now turn with me to Hebrews chapter 7, verse 15. We're going to look and see how the author of Hebrews says Melchizedek was pointing us to Jesus. Hebrews chapter 7, verse 15. I'll give you a moment to turn there. And verse 15 says this. This becomes even more evident when another priest arises in the likeness of Melchizedek, who has become a priest not on the basis of a legal requirement concerning bodily descent, but by the power of an indestructible life. For it is witnessed of him, you are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Okay, so what does this mean? This means that there's another priest not related to Aaron, not that's based on, you know, God gave his law and he said, you know, the descendants of Aaron, the sons of Aaron are going to be priests. The author says there's a new thing happening that's not based on the Old Testament law, not based on human descent, but the power of an indestructible life. What is that? Well, 2 weeks ago, we celebrated Easter, and we celebrated Jesus dying and rising again from the dead. Will Jesus ever die again? No. Death could not hold him down. His life is indestructible. Jesus lives forever. And so, if Jesus lives forever, he can save us. Any other person will let us down. Any other person will eventually die or be weak or anything like that. But no, Jesus has power, an indestructible, forever living life. And he has the power to be our priest and our king forever. David wrote Psalm 110. And verse 17 quotes from that where it says, "You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." David was king in Jerusalem, kind of like Melchizedek was. And David was looking forward to Jesus, his descendant, that was going to be a priest forever. And we know that Jesus is a priest forever because he will never die again. Are we following? Does that make some sense? And so here we look at Jesus as a priest. So, okay, he's a priest forever. What does that mean for us? And if you look in if you continue in this chapter, we're going to get to it. It talks about drawing near to God. We're going to talk about that here in a moment. A priest helps someone draw near to God, right? A priest is kind of like a go-between, kind of like a mediator person. Helps someone come near, come close, be next to God. And so Jesus is that priest for us. And I want you to notice something. In this passage, it says that we draw near to God. It doesn't say you get kind of close to God. It doesn't say you see God at a distance. It doesn't say, like, you call God on the phone, but he's far away. No, it says we draw near to God in a real way. And God invites that over and over and over as he tells us to come and to pray and to be with him. Jesus says, "Abide in me, and you will bear much fruit. You can do nothing apart from me." Draw near to God. Draw near to God. And it says that through Jesus, we can do that. And we're promised that if we draw near to God, James 4:8, he will draw near to us. And so God is inviting that nearness. Sometimes you may feel like God wants you at arm's length, separate, away. You've done too bad. You've seen too much. You've said too much. God wants you to draw near. And he gives us a way to do that through Jesus. Come near to him. As we keep going in verse 18, it says, "For on the one hand, a former commandment is set aside because of its weakness and uselessness, for the law made nothing perfect. But on the other hand, a better hope is introduced through which we draw near to God." We have a better hope. The priests in the Old Testament, guess what? They died. In some way they let people down. God made the priesthood. God gave the law, but he knew that there was limitations because the sacrifices and the things that the priest did weren't perfect. And they would eventually die, and they let people down. But Jesus will never let you down. We have a better hope. We have a way to be saved that is sure, that is complete, that is given by God, and he invites us to draw near. We have a better hope, a new hope, a living hope, an indestructible hope in Jesus. Be encouraged, believer. You have that. You're never too far. You've never strayed too far. You've never been away long enough that you can't get back in. Draw near to God. Today, draw near to him. He invites you. He gives you this hope. That hope is Jesus. Draw near to God, because he'll never let you down. So we look at this better hope, There was a good hope given by God, and it worked, but this way of coming to God is so much better. It's so much better. We're going to look at that here in verses 22 through 25. In 22, it says, "This makes Jesus the guarantee of a better covenant. The former priests were many in number because they were prevented by death from continuing in office. But Jesus holds his priesthood permanently because he continues. He lives forever. Consequently, he is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them." We have a guarantee from God himself, and his name is Jesus. We have a guarantee that since Jesus lives forever, we can draw near to God through him. We have hope. We have assurance. Jesus is not going to die. Jesus is not going to let us down. Jesus is not going to turn us away. We have a guarantee. What is guaranteed in this life? Weakness, death, taxes, disappointments, the Cubs not doing well for a good stretch of time. Guaranteed. I'm a Cubs fan, so wait till next year. But we have a guarantee from God himself. It says it's by the word of an oath. God gave his promise. He cannot lie. And he's given us a guarantee through Jesus. He's not going to let us down. Jesus lives forever so that he can save us completely. It says here, to the uttermost, all the way, no matter where you go, what you've done, who you are, Jesus can save you and me to the uttermost, completely, as we draw near to God through him, as we repent of our sins, as we pray and ask forgiveness, as we seek to follow him, as we love God, as we love our neighbor, we're drawing near to God. And Jesus says, through me and me alone, you're going to be saved. I have the power. I live forever, never to die again. We have a guarantee from God. Now it mentions the old way, in the old covenant, the covenant God gave to Moses. There were many priests, for there were many people with many sins. There were a lot of priests going on, and they couldn't continue on because eventually they died. And they sacrificed animals over and over. Someone, an Israelite who sacrificed an animal, probably sacrificed a lot of animals throughout their life because there were many sins, right? Many, you sacrifice an animal, then you go on your way, and then you sin again, and you got to sacrifice. You know, it just kept on going. It just kept on going. Priests died, new ones came, over and over and over. And it couldn't make people perfect. Imagine you had to rely on someone to pray and be forgiven by God. If anything happened to them, if they died, if they let you down, you'd be in kind of like a panic mode, right? You'd be like, oh, my hope is gone. My person is gone. And that's kind of the situation in the Old Testament. Priests died. And I'm sure there was a bit of a panic mode, but Jesus never dies. He is always, 24/7, he is always able to serve you, to minister to you, to be the one who draws you near to God and plead and intercede for you when you mess up, always. He'll never let you down there. No one else can make a promise like this, but Jesus can. He will never let you down. How do we know? How do we know that Jesus will never let me down? He's in heaven, I'm on earth, I can't see him. How do I know that Jesus will never let us down? How do I know that there's no weakness in him, that he won't forget about me, that he won't turn away from me, that he won't get fed up with me and angry at me enough to the point where he checks out? How do we know? Verse 26, let's take a look. For it is indeed fitting that we should have a high priest, holy, innocent, unstained, separated from sinners, and exalted above the heavens. That might sound scary. Separated from sinners? I'm a sinner. That's not good, but it is good. Why is it good? Because Jesus came holy, unstained, pure, perfect. And you know why? So that we could receive his goodness. From his fullness, we receive grace upon grace. Jesus lived a perfect life so that we could be credited with that perfect life. Have you ever gotten a credit on your bill? That's good. That's a lot better when it's like a negative bill. It's like, yeah, they owe me money, right? It's kind of like God credits our account with what Jesus has done. Pure, holy, undefiled, separated from sinners. Jesus gives that to us. Jesus was good where we aren't. He has no character weakness. And you know what is included in that? Perfect patience. Perfect patience for sinners. Perfect patience for us who are weak. And God knows we're weak. He knows we're flesh. He knows we are dust. Dust. We're weak. But Jesus has no weakness. He lives forever. He has the power of an indestructible life. When Jesus was tired and in pain and being wronged, even in his earthly life, guess what he did? He blessed. And he prayed for people. Forgive them. Jesus has no character weakness. Jesus will never let us down. Jesus will never turn his back on us, never leave us or forsake us. There's no stain of sin on him. When you have a shirt that has a big stain on it, it's ruined. When you have a carpet that has a big stain on it from your dog or your cat, it's kind of ruined unless you can get it out. Usually it's like it's kind of out, you know. But Jesus had no stain. He was unstained by sin. He was never ruined. People will let you down. Fact of life. In our weakness, we let others down, and other people let us down. You have been a victim of people letting you down. And others have been a victim of you letting them down. And not only will other people let you down, you will let you down. We sin, other people sin. We're weak, they're weak. We'll die, and they'll die. People will let you down, but not Jesus. Jesus will never let you down. You might say, but Jesus died. Why did he die? If he's so powerful, if he had this indestructible life, why did he die? Let me tell you, it was for us. Verses 27 and 28 here in Hebrews 7. Jesus has no need, like those other high priests, to offer sacrifices daily, first for his own sins and then for those of the people, since he did this once for all when he offered up himself. Sit on that. He did this once for all when he offered up himself. The only reason Jesus died, it wasn't for his own sin, it was for my sin. It was for your sin. He died. He became weak for us so that he could raise again and show the power of him living forever to save those who are weak. Kind of amazing. Verse 28, for the law appoints men in their weakness as high priests. But the word of an oath came later than the law, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever. Made perfect. You know anyone who's perfect? I do, Jesus, that's it. He's made perfect forever. He's a guarantee. He helps us draw near to God. He's our priest. He's our king. And he will never let us down. We got to hold on to that. That is our hope. He laid down his life once for all, and he took it up again so that he could be our friend. It's a good friend. He brings us to God. He saves us. Once for all sacrifice for all of our sin. We don't have to repeat. We don't have to start over. We repent, we come to God, we draw near through Jesus who forgives all our sin. That's good. That's good. Let me get an amen. I can't hear you, but let me get one. Come on. We can be encouraged as believers because we have a trustworthy Savior. Our hope is that Jesus lives forever. We have a guarantee to come to God. Guaranteed. God became flesh and went through physical weakness, but he was raised in power. He doesn't think he's indestructible like I did. He doesn't think that, you know, I can do anything I did in high school. He is. He'll never fail. He has no weakness. He has no emotional weakness. Jesus was always there for others, and he's always there for you. He knew what to do and to say all the time because he obeyed God his Father. He was led by the Spirit, and he knows how to serve you in your situation. He has no weakness. I let people down. You let people down. But Jesus will never let us down. Never. Never. Let's strive to be like him. Let's strive to take up the power that he has and live by the power of the Holy Spirit like he did. Not let people down, but trusting God's strength. When we do let people down, when we let ourselves down, when we let God down, we have a hope. We have a promise. And let's draw near to God through him as much as we can. Let's pray hard because we have someone who is praying with us, Jesus, our undying, unfailing Lord, King, Priest, Savior. He loves us. Let's remember that. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you that he is perfect. He will never let us down. Help us pray hard. Help us abide in you. Help us hold fast to him. Help us trust him. When we fail, Jesus does not. When we are unfaithful, he is faithful. Help us draw near. Now we pray the prayer that Jesus himself has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As we close, I want to read from Romans chapter 8, where it talks about Jesus living forever to plead for us. If you look in Romans 8, pretty good, pretty familiar verses. Romans 8, starting in verse 31. What shall we say then to these things? If God is for us, he is. Who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for his all, for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died once for all. More than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of God? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? Then in verse 37, no. In all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Draw near to God. Nothing can separate us from his love in Christ. Draw near to him this week. Draw near to him as you go home or as you're at home. Draw near to him at work. Draw near to him before bed. Draw near to him as you rise up. Nothing can separate you from his love, and he wants you to be near. May God bless you.